Next up, we have someone from a different perspective to talk to us who's been interested in the state of the oceans for just about as long as Dr. Feely. And that is someone who Dr. Feely mentioned in his talk, which is Bill Dewey, who is the Public Policy and Communications Director for Taylor Shellfish Farms in Shelton, Washington, which is near Seattle on the Olympic Peninsula. And so Bill's going to give us sort of the commercial side of this, where this is an industry, as we saw in Dr. Feely's talk, that they've already seen some impacts. And so we'd like to hear from him. Thanks.
Well, good morning, and thank you for the invitation to come participate in this panel. I've joined Dr. Feely on a number of these different panels, and always feel like I've been punched in the gut every time I watch his presentation. It's not a very heartening message, and certainly one that we as an industry have been experiencing, as he mentioned, firsthand. So what I'll do this morning is share with you a little bit about shellfish farms. Probably a number of you are not familiar with what's involved in shellfish farming, so you can better understand what's being impacted. I'll talk about our seed production problems that Dick referred to, what we're doing to address them, what the economic consequences have been, and then touch on the Blue Ribbon panel as well as Dick has. So our shellfish farms, most of our farms on the west coast of the United States are intertidal. Washington State leads the country in farm shellfish production. It's kind of unique in that we can own our tide lands in Washington State. So this is a graphic from northern Puget Sound, Samish Bay. We have a lot of areas that look like this, but all those polygons that you see out in the bay are parcels of tidelands that were purchased in the early 1900s under laws that our legislature passed to encourage shellfish farming in Washington State. And those range in size anywhere from 5 to 100 acres in size. And I should just real quickly some background on Taylor Shellfish Farms. The Taylor family has been growing shellfish in Washington State since 1890. So the fifth generation is involved in doing that now. I've been involved for about 30 years. Besides the work I do for Taylor's, I have a shellfish farm of my own that I do on the side. I grow manila clams on the weekends and in my spare time, and feeling very refreshed today, actually, after 5 days of working the tides on my farm. And that's kind of my therapy from doing the public policy work, as I grow clams. So enjoy that a lot. Washington, as I said, dominates the West Coast, but we also have a vibrant industry in California and Oregon as well. And you'll see some pictures of that as we go. Some pictures from the farms. This is really what's dominated our industry for many, many decades, is just bottom culture of clusters of Pacific oysters that are harvested, and the meats are shucked from them and sold as fresh shucked meats. That industry has transitioned a lot in recent decades to where we're now growing single oysters. I'll talk about that briefly, but this is another way we grow those clusters of Pacific oysters if the bottom is too muddy and won't support the crop. Where the oysters would sink in and suffocate and die, we grow them up on ropes and stakes up off the bottom. And then, as I mentioned, the industry's transitioned to single oysters. A lot of the raw oyster bar trade is really resurged in the United States. It's a huge market for us and a growing market for us. So we're growing a lot more single oysters. It's a different process to produce the single oyster seed. But this is a bed of singles on the bottom. A lot of areas where you have predators that will eat those single oysters, you have to protect them. So this is in Tomales Bay, Hog Island Oyster Company there. They grow their oysters in bags to keep the bat rays from eating the oysters. We grow the same single oysters there. There's another method that a number of growers have started using. These are bags. This is all intertidal, so at high tide, this would be under 10 feet of water or so. But these bags are hanging on a cable system. Each of the bags has a buoy on it. So as the tide comes in, that bag rotates up. And then as the tide drops, the bag rotates down. So the oysters are basically in constant motion as they grow. And it changes the shape of the oyster. It changes the morphology of the shell. It gives them a nice round, deep cup, removes all the fluting from the shell. And this is how we market them here. We call them our shigoku, which means the ultimate oyster. And it's a really a wonderful, wonderful product. Manila clams, this is what I grow on my farm. In fact, this picture in the lower left is from my farm up in Samish Bay. We grow clams under predator netting to keep diving ducks and crabs from eating them. In a lot of areas, we have problems with predators, so we have to protect them. Or just blanket farm on the bottom, as you see in the lower right, that's a crew harvesting the clams. Upper right, they grow them in bags also as well. Mussels is a suspended culture product. We do this from rafts. So this is in Totten Inlet in southern Puget Sound in Washington State, where the mussels are grown on ropes that hang down from the rafts. Again, the seed, all of these crops, as I've mentioned, the seed is produced in hatcheries today to supply the farms. And geoduck is our large burrowing clam on the West Coast, largest burrowing clam in the world. These clams get big in the wild. They get up to 16 pounds, get very old. The oldest geoduck that they've aged alive, I think, was 164 years old. Fortunately for us as farmers, they grow very fast for the first 5 years, and then they kind of level out for the next 155. So we can actually grow a geoduck the size of the one in the lower left there, around 2 pounds. We can do that in about 6 years on our farms. The seed look like the adults. They're very vulnerable, and so we plant them in these nursery tubes that you see in the lower right for the first year or so, and then we remove the tubes, and they just grow there in the beach like you see in the upper right for the next 5 years. So our seed's produced in the hatcheries. Hatchery technology evolved in the Pacific Northwest in the late 1960s, early 1970s, and is really the dominant way we generate most of our seed now. What goes on in the hatchery, you know, with all of these bivalves, the first 3 weeks of their life, they're essentially free floating. They're plankton, free swimming in the water. After a few weeks, they've put on enough shell. They're no longer buoyant. They settle to the bottom, and they go through a metamorphosis to begin their life on the bottom. And it's that metamorphosis is different for each of the species. In the case of oysters, they secrete a cement, and they glue themselves onto something where they live for the rest of their life. So from an evolution standpoint, they like to glue onto oyster shell. That's their preferred substrate. With Manila clams, they just burrow into the substrate, or geoduck clams, they just burrow into the substrate. Mussels, they secrete abyssal thread as they come out of the water column and attach on and grow attached to pilings or ropes or whatever with their abyssal threads. So we grow the larvae in these big fiberglass tanks. The larvae have a ciliated arm called a vellum that they feed and motate with when they're in the plankton stage that you see there in the middle. No artificial food for these guys in the hatchery, so a lot of the energy is spent growing multiple different species of phytoplankton to feed them as they grow through the different larval stages. So we have greenhouses and a lot of effort to grow algae. Lower left there, that's a 75 micron screen that they're changing an oyster larvae tank. So they're siphoning the water out of the big fiberglass tank, and that's about 3 million baby oysters that have collected on that screen. It's probably about a foot and a half in diameter there. So there's an intermediate stage between the hatchery and the farms. We have multiple nurseries at different locations. This is what we call our FLUPSI, our floating upwell system. So they get them off the hatchery, produce food onto food that's growing in the bay, and just put them in these protected containers and pump the water through these little tiny babies so that they can feed in a protected environment and grow to the size we can take them out to the farm and plant them. Lower left is our nursery system in Oakland Bay in southern Puget Sound. Lower right is a FLUPSI that we have in Humboldt Bay. Our company has a large nursery operation in Humboldt Bay as well. We also have a hatchery over in Kona, Hawaii, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. But essentially the reason for that, about 20 years ago, as we struggled to grow baby oysters in Washington State in the wintertime in our nurseries, you know, you need sunlight to grow this algae. The ambient water is cold, the animals go dormant, so you gotta heat that water up to get the animals' metabolism up to eat this algae that you're fighting Mother Nature to grow. And so about 20 years ago, we got to thinking, you know, these guys are tiny. We can put 20 million of them in a six-pack beer cooler, put a gel ice pack, we can fly them anywhere in the world. Let's go find some place easier to do that. And Kona surfaced as the spot, and it's been an incredibly successful endeavor for us. And it's allowed us to produce seed very efficiently in the wintertime, boosted up to planting size, and it's really been a boon. We sell seed, besides to our own company, we sell seed to the industry all up and down the West Coast, and everybody has benefited from this because Instead of fighting Mother Nature and getting seed ready to plant by July or August, we now get it back in March from Kona all ready to go, and it gains us almost a whole year in our growing season by getting that seed back early from Kona. Well, as it turns out, it's also been a dramatic improvement for us, or a help for us, as our seed production has failed in Washington State due to ocean acidification. We've been able to offset some of that production with our Kona facility. So this is a gooey duck seed nursery. You can see how the baby gooey ducks look like the adults and are very, very fragile when we go to plant them. So these are the different hatchery facilities on the west coast of the United States. Taylor's have, as I mentioned, a facility in Hawaii. We have a nursery in Humboldt Bay in Northern California. And then we have our hatchery on the Hood Canal. Coast Seafoods has another large hatchery on the Hood Canal in a bay adjacent to ours. The Whiskey Creek Hatchery is a big facility in Neatarts Bay, Oregon. Really, it's the Whiskey Creek Hatchery and our hatchery on Daybob Bay are the two that have experienced major production problems due to the ocean acidification issue. And then the Lummi Indian Nation has a hatchery in northern Puget Sound up near Bellingham. Goose Point is a Willapa Bay oyster company. They got a lot of national press here recently when they opened up a hatchery as well in Hawaii to offset the seed losses that they were having at their farm in Willapa Bay. So back in 2006, we started to really see some of our first problems producing oyster seed that were across the board in hatcheries as well as with our natural sets in the wild. And early on, the focus was on a naturally occurring marine bacteria, Vibrio tubiaci. And so a lot of energy put into this by both scientists and the industry on how to get this tubiaci out of the water, some major investments in filtration equipment to do that, only to find out that the oysters were still dying after we got the tubiaci out of the water. So something bigger was going on. In 2008, Dick Feely was the keynote speaker at our Shellfish Growers Conference. We'd gotten wind that this ocean acidification thing might be what's causing our problems, and Dick confirmed that for us when he came and spoke to us in 2008. Very somber message. You know, you can imagine to have him deliver the talk that he gave to you, to a bunch of oyster growers, to tell them that, you know, the reason your baby oysters are dying is because of all the CO2 that's being emitted by the rest of the world, and, you know, not a lot you can do about that, probably individually as oyster growers. And oh, by the way, you know, the exclamation point at that talk for me was, oh, by the way, these waters that are upwelling off the coast and causing your baby oysters to die are actually 30 to 50 years old. So even if we can convince the world to stop emitting CO2 today, the problem's going to get worse for the next 30 to 50 years before it starts to get better. Not very good news for the oyster industry. So these are just headlines today. Things haven't changed all that much, although now the focus is around ocean acidification, not on tubiaci, although that still is an issue for us. Some of the losses that our hatchery and the Whiskey Creek hatchery experienced are reflected here. 2007, 8, and 9 were some of our worst years where production was off very dramatically. The blue bars for Whiskey Creek are what you see the decline that happened there. For us, it's a little more confusing. The white bars within the blue helped us achieve actually an increase in recent years, but it was mainly due to things that we did to offset the losses. So we increased our capacity in the building. You know, so we were still experiencing losses in our larvae production, but we were offsetting that by trying to make more tanks and more facility to grow to offset that. But this was also a very interesting photo for us, fall of last year. You know, we see these oyster larvae die and we look at them under our microscopes, but we can't see them in enough detail to understand what's actually happening to them. And last year, with some help of a nonprofit, we were able to secure some funding to get some time on Oregon State University's scanning electron microscope and actually look at these things at a magnification where we could see what was happening to the shell. And at our hatchery on the Hood Canal, we have two intakes. We have a shallow intake that typically, as we've learned now with the monitoring, brings in very good seawater, and a deep water intake at 100 feet that brings in very corrosive seawater. And this is the first 4 days of life basically grown side by side with water from those two different intakes. So on the left is water that has got a pH of around 8 and a CO2 level of around 390, and on the right is a pH of around 7.5 and a CO2 level of around 1400. So you can see the difference just in the first 4 days of life. And as Dick mentioned in his talk, this is at this stage in their life when they're working off of this yolk, essentially, this fat store in the egg. And when if they don't have a high aragonite saturation and they're struggling to build that shell, you can see the deformities, and eventually that oyster on the right perishes. So this is what was going on with the natural recruitment. So Willapa Bay is where a big portion of our industry is on the West Coast. At times, they're producing roughly 25% of the country's oysters in this estuary. A lot of the growers there rely on natural recruitment to reseed their beds. And you can see over time from back in 1942 how we get blips in natural reproduction, right? The Pacific oyster is an introduced species to the West Coast, introduced here from Japan in the early 1900s, naturalized in a few areas, including Willapa Bay. And you can see there's enough natural reproduction to collect seed from, but then from 2005 on, we had 7 years essentially without natural sets. So, and this corresponded with the years when our hatcheries had major failures as well. So this created the seed crisis that got a lot of media attention and that Dick mentioned as well. So for our company, it's been a combination of panic and adaptation. Panic, obviously, when we got the message from Dick in 2008. We're a little more encouraged today. The monitoring that we've been able to do to see this water has allowed us to do some adaptation and some research. We've expanded our production at Daybob as well as in our facility over in Kona to offset our losses. This is what is referred to as the Burkulator. Burke Hills developed this for real-time monitoring of the CO2, which has been extremely insightful. And more sophisticated pH monitoring equipment as well, increasing production in Kona. The interesting thing that's happened this past winter, which has turned out to be, looks to be early yet, but looks to be very beneficial, is with this real-time monitoring providing feedback, we're automatically buffering the water in our hatchery. So we have a system that's injecting sodium carbonate into the water to bring the aragonite saturation up. We initially started at 1 because that's what the scientists were telling us we need to get above so that things weren't dissolving. And the Whiskey Creek Hatchery, who we coordinate very closely with, says, you think 1 works good? Bump it up to 3 and watch what happens. And so we did. We bumped it up to 3 and have gotten amazing results. The oyster larvae survival has been dramatic this spring. Everybody is cautiously optimistic that maybe we really have found a winner here to help us push through this. So that's kind of an exciting development for us. And as an aside, our geoduck seed are thriving in this treated water as well, which is, we've always struggled producing geoduck seed because the shells are so thin and so fragile. And now they're, with this treatment, the shells are thick and hard and the seed are doing great as well. So the other thing the monitoring has allowed us to do, this is from Whiskey Creek. They know now from monitoring that when the wind shifts to the north, they've got about a 24-hour window before that corrosive water shows up at their intake pipe. And so they can pump like crazy when they see that one's going to shift. They pump like crazy, fill their tanks, and then turn off and try to avoid that corrosive water. They generally will go about 3 days with a larvae culture before they need to change. But now they're, you know, if it's still corrosive out there, they'll hang on to that water for 4 or 5 days and not do a water change rather than bring corrosive water in that they know will kill their larvae. The other thing, you know, it's a simple thing, but it's made a big difference for them, is they used to come to work at 8 o'clock in the morning, they'd turn the pumps on and fill the tanks to start their work and growing larvae, and lo and behold, with the monitoring equipment, they've come to realize that if they wait until 3 o'clock in the afternoon until the eelgrass and phytoplankton in Neatarts Bay have photosynthesized, they'll naturally change that seawater chemistry in Neatarts Bay and then get much better water in at 3 in the afternoon instead of at 8 in the morning. So little things like that have allowed them to recover up to 75% of their production in their hatchery as well. So the more we know, the more we don't. And this is obviously a challenge for us, but we've had a great alliance with scientists from Oregon State University, University of Washington, NOAA. There's been a wonderful collaboration of scientists trying to help us push through these issues and get the hatcheries producing seed again. But there's a lot of other characteristics in seawater that may be contributing to the problems that we're having. Also, the role of Vibrio tubiaci, you know, it's been interesting this year Tubuyoshi was definitely the problem back in 2006. This year, we do bacteriology on our hatchery water every week, and Tubuyoshi levels are extremely high right now in our hatchery, and by all past experience, they should be just wiping out our oyster larvae right now, and our oyster larvae continue to thrive. And we think it's because we've got that aragonite saturation up that they don't succumb to the stresses of this bacteria like they did when that saturation was low. So, still learning. So, Dick's already talked a little bit about the economic value of that West Coast industry and what a big deal it is if we don't have seed. Over the five-year period where we really struggled on seed production, it takes a while. These oysters are a 2 to 4 year crop, but our production dropped on the West Coast, dropped about 20%, and we're starting to see a little bit of a recovery from that now since we've been having some good luck producing seeds since 2010 in the hatcheries. So, Dick also mentioned the Blue Ribbon Panel. This was the report that was generated, a lot of great recommendations there. Washington's Governor Gregoire is really to be credited for stepping forward and making Washington the first state in the union to try to address this problem. The 42 recommendations in there, I think, are eye-openers and show that there are things that we can do locally to address the problem, as well as speak out and try to affect global policies related to CO2 emissions. There are things that we can do locally as well. So I'll close with this just to say, that Pacific oysters are, I think, and that's probably the reason I was invited here today, in a lot of respects, serving the same purpose as the canaries did in the coal mines, trying to recognize the toxic gases to the miners. Is hopefully what's happening to our oyster larvae is an eye-opener to others, because as you heard from Dick, there's a lot of other organisms out there in the ocean being affected by these conditions. We're very fortunate as an industry that the vulnerable stage of our animals that we're farming happens during a time when they're in a building in a tank where we can manipulate that seawater chemistry. All the other organisms out in the ocean don't necessarily have that luxury of being able to come into a safe harbor for the vulnerable part of their life. So I think we all need to recognize that this is a serious issue that the world needs to grapple with. So thank you, and I'll stop there.